Okay, this will be part two of our look at the moisture and air mass modification process. This one we're going to focus on what happens with the returning moist layer inland depending on the underlying land conditions there. So it's not only is the influence of the ocean and the return flow and air mass modification phase, but what happens over land is relevant because we're still adding additional complications to the moisture return process. So here I've summarized some of the important things you need to consider when we're looking at what happens to the moisture when it comes back inland. You can actually see decreases in the moisture during the day. And I know that a lot of people think of that as, well, that's counterintuitive. It's when daytime vertical mixing extends deeper than the depth of the moist layer, when the horizontal moisture advection is not enough to offset the mixing. And this is all compounded when you have dry soil or stressed vegetation, which is typical of ongoing drought conditions. So I'm going to show a case where the assumptions of what it looks like in the morning would mislead you during the afternoon if you don't consider the entire situation. Okay, so here's a surface map, and I've sketched in the dew points, the 60 isodrosotherm from about Interstate 70 in Kansas southward, splotchy 64 dew points. It's clear that there's a little bit of variation in the moisture field from central Oklahoma down into Texas, but in general, the dew points do not increase dramatically from here near Salina, Kansas with a 60 dew point all the way down into southeast Texas with dew points just of 64. So there's not a lot of horizontal variation in this case. So the first thing you might think is that horizontal advection is not going to be particularly strong from south to north because we just don't have much of a moisture gradient. And if we jump up to 850 millibars, the mandatory pressure level analysis from this morning at the same time, we have a southerly to south-southwesterly low-level jet. The analysis, which is based on the model first guess field, shows a little bit of moist extending up as high as 850. Notice it's between all the sounding sites. The dew points in green are all relatively low. So what this tells us is that the moist layer is fairly shallow. It does not extend as high as the 850 millibar pressure surface. So first, as an experienced forecaster, the first thing I might think is that vertical mixing could be a problem in this sort of scenario. We don't have big horizontal variations, big upstream increases in moisture, and the moisture depth is somewhat questionable. And add to that, here's satellite image from mid-morning the same day. It's sunny everywhere south of the cloud bank in eastern Nebraska. Almost full sunshine, so we would think heating and mixing are going to be quite pronounced during this event. And I'll show you what it looks like with the soundings and what that does to the convective potential. And we're going to focus on starting in central Oklahoma, and then we'll work our way up to Omaha, Nebraska, in eastern Nebraska on the Missouri River. Okay, so I did mention that you need to consider the background conditions. Here's a case where we have extreme drought in the southern plains, the red areas, and then the drought conditions diminish to something much more normal as you get up toward northeast Nebraska. There's no long or short-term drought noted. So it's drier relative to the conditions typically you would see as you go from north to south. So we dry with southward extent, and that's would say something about the vegetation is likely not very healthy, and there's not much soil moisture content. Okay, so again, the diurnal changes, this is kind of a rehash of what I summarized at the beginning. We need to know how deep is the mixing going to be, what's the characteristic of the upstream moisture, is the soil moist, is there a lot of green vegetation to help with moist transpiration and evaporation in the boundary there. And so what we'll do is I'll illustrate this particular mixing case starting at Norman, and then we'll go up to the Lamont sounding site in northern Oklahoma, and then we will hit Omaha in eastern Nebraska. So this is the Fort Worth sounding. This would be considered upstream from Norman at the start of this event. We notice we have a steep lapse rate layer, and it's very warm. Moist layer, relatively modest by North Texas standards for early April. And if we continue up to Norman, it's actually a little bit more unstable using the most unstable lifted parcel. And if you look at the comparison of the moist layer, it's actually richer moisture at Norman. So that's one of the red flags. It's like, why the moisture actually looks better at Norman to start the day than it does in Fort Worth, which is upstream. So considering that, we don't have a lot of horizontal advection. We're going to have full sun and vertical mixing. You might actually expect, if the mixing extends higher than the depth of this moist layer, which is well below 850 millibars, we might actually expect to see mixing down of drier air during the day. So this is what happened to the observed Norman sounding at 0Z. And if you notice, we start in the morning, you would see relatively large buoyancy. This is Cape in excess of 2,000 joules per kilogram for the most unstable parcel. And yes, there's a lot of convective inhibition in the lower part of the profile lifting this. Cape actually decreases during the afternoon. So we warm up and the Cape goes down. And if you don't think about the vertical structure of the moisture profile and the fact that we're redistributing this in the vertical, you're going to end up with a forecast where you might be kind of surprised. So you could imagine this sounding at 0Z, it's going to be hard to get thunderstorms looking at this. Okay, let's go. Norman is, and then we're going to look at Lamont, Oklahoma, which is close to the Kansas border. This is, Norman is the upstream sounding for Lamont. You've seen that moisture profile already. Lamont looks pretty similar, 12Z. So these are no big change between those two, so you wouldn't expect a much different evolution between the two sites. And then Lamont actually launches special sounding, so we can look at the mixing process in a two-stage process here as opposed to just getting one snapshot sounding. So this is 18Z, early afternoon. We've already seen the influence of vertical mixing, and we've reduced the surface dew points. And then the same thing continues to 0Z. So just stepping back, we just see a deepening of the mix layer. The precipitable water in the sounding doesn't change much, but the distribution, the moisture, instead of being concentrated into the surface, it's now redistributed through a deeper layer with lower mixing ratios overall. Which, and again, you notice the buoyancy, it actually goes down at Lamont, and there's still a pronounced inversion above the moist layer. So convective potential questionable with this kind of evolution. Now what happens way up on the north end? Different looking profile at Omaha to start. If you remember, we had the cloud band all the way to the north. That was essentially the surface warm front. So we've got a very shallow cool air mass here right near the ground, but it's moist above that in the slope frontal surface. And then if we continue down, we see, or that was actually Topeka, and then at Omaha, oops, my bad. I gave away the answer a little too quick there. But this is Topeka upstream. This is Omaha with a little deeper cool air in the morning. If you think about what that does, we have to move the boundary north, but this also shelters vertical mixing. Now we've got the mixing, any heating and mixing is trapped down in this layer, and we have richer upstream moisture to advect into the region from the south. So when we do this, you modify the Omaha sounding through all these processes. This is a tornadic supercell sounding, much different character to this than we had down to the south. And if you think it doesn't matter in the distribution of the severe weather events for this case, that string of numerous tornadoes, several of them significant, even after dark into northwestern Iowa. And down in the southern part, the hail in Kansas was much later. So we essentially had a null event down toward Oklahoma, and we had a significant tornado event on the north edge of the returning moisture. And it's primarily due to not only changes in the wind profile, but the sheltering of the moist layer. And even though we didn't have particularly rich moisture in the southern plains, if you transfer this environment northward and appropriate modifications, you can actually create a rather interesting tornado setup somewhere else, even with what looks like rather mediocre moisture to start with. So again, we'll just sort of summarize the vertical mixing. During the daytime, it's the vertical moisture structure that matters the most. We need the height and strength of the cap, or our informal reference to that base of the elevated mix layer. And what do we have as an upstream moisture source? And if we have one, we can offset the mixing. If we don't, typically you'll see the dew points drop off. And do we have any local moisture sources? Are we going to be evaporating moisture from the ground upward into the boundary there? Or do we have green vegetation or crops that are transpiring? All of these things matter. In this case, with the drought conditions to the south and not so much to the north, everything suggested north would be more interesting based on the observed data.